name is Furman Fordham. I am the senior pastor of Riverside here in Nashville. And we want to welcome you to our Riverside family and to our ministry. We are so happy that you have tuned in. Our prayer is that you will come to know God, grow in God, and sow God's love. We are praying that this presentation will be a blessing to you. And if you are ever in Nashville, we invite you to come worship with us. May God bless you, and we look forward to seeing you soon.
God is good, amen. Oh, you're supposed to say all the time, God is good, amen. And all the time, God is good. I'm pleased and happy to be here with you today. Just briefly, before we get into the word, I'm not big on introductions or words or anything like that, but just want to thank Pastor Fordham for inviting me, your associate pastor as well, for taking care of me, everybody who's been involved in bringing me here. I'm grateful to be here today. How many of you are happy just to be in the house of the Lord? It's just a blessing. Amen. I was wondering if you'd do me a favor, if you would take your Bibles in hand or your smartphones or whatever. There is a custom in the churches where I pastor. And yes, by the way, you heard correctly, I do pastor four churches. Amen. But we have a custom where we stand when God's word is about to be read. And I would invite you to indulge me in that custom. We stand when our babies graduate and we shout aloud. We stand when we go to the NFL football game and our favorite team scores a touchdown. I think it's all right if we stand for God's word. Amen. Genesis. If you can't find that, you're in trouble. Genesis. Chapter 22 and verses 1 through 7. I want to read it again in your hearing from the NIV version. The Word of God says, sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, here I am, he replied. Then God said, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I will tell you about. Early, early, early the next morning, Abraham got up and saddled his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. And when he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance, and he said to his servants, yo, stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship. We will what? And then we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife, and the two of them went on together. Isaac then spoke up and said to his father Abraham, father, daddy. Yes, my son, Abraham replied. The fire and the wood are here, Isaac said. But where, oh, where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Pray with me. Father, in the name of Jesus today, I need your help. I am completely incapable of communicating eternal truths to your people. I would ask today, O God, that you would hide me behind the cross. I am not eloquent enough. I'm not skillful enough. I don't have enough education, enough degrees, O God, to speak about things that have eternal spiritual value. And so, Lord, I ask for the infilling of your spirit. I also pray, O God, that you would remove all distractions out of this room, that you would arrest every demonic force, that we would have not come into the house of God in vain today, leaving out the same way that we came in. Forgive us of sins and shortcomings and mistakes. Forgive us of delayed disobedience. Forgive us of intentional disobedience. Forgive us of being disobedient in commands that we are ignorant of, sins done, and that we don't even know of. Father, forgive us today. I pray, O Lord, that the words that are spoken may be meet in due season for your people. In Jesus' name I do pray. Let everyone say amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. It is a powerful story, an amazing story, really. It is one of those stories that if Steven Spielberg decided to make a cinematic presentation out of it, when people went to see it in the theater, there would not be a dry eye in the house. It is an amazing story about a father's love for his son. In fact, I would tell you that I believe this is the first place in the Bible where the term love is even mentioned. Not only is it the first place where love is mentioned, it is the first place in the Bible where love is ceremoniously and very eventfully described and defined in the Word of God. Think about it for a moment. It's really emotionally gut-wrenching. Abraham has waited 25 plus years for this son, Isaac. He has prayed and waited for the promise that God was going to give him a son. Finally, Sarah's dead womb, mind you, you ought to say amen. Sarah's dead womb coughs up a son and his birth, and his name is Isaac. And you can imagine Abraham being joyful about the fact that he finally has a son, a mini-me, a junior Abraham that he's going to take care of, that is going to further his lineage and his family line. Imagine Abraham holding little baby Isaac, coddling him. He even gets joy out of changing little Isaac's diapers. He gets joy out of the fact that Isaac takes his first steps. He gets joy out of the fact that Isaac speaks his first words, mama, dada. He can throw the ball in the yard with Isaac. He teaches Isaac things that he should know as a man. There is an unbreakable bond between a father and a son. I didn't say a baby daddy and a son. But a true father has an almost unconditional love for his son. Would you say amen? Not talking about a brother who spends more money on his car than taking care of the kids that he has sown all over the city. True father loves his son. And it's an unbreakable bond that nobody can break. And Abraham loves his son. And so imagine at the moment that God speaks out from heaven and says to him, Abraham, here I am, Lord. I want you to take your son, go to a land that I'm going to show you, and bring him up there and sacrifice him as a burnt offering unto me. Can you imagine the emotional anguish and agony that Abraham was going through in his heart and in his mind, that he would have to sacrifice his own son? Nevertheless, Abraham, the word says, he gets up early the next morning. And can you imagine him taking the axe and cutting the wood, the same wood that would be the kindling to set his son's flesh on fire? Can you imagine Abraham taking the knife and putting it into his satchel because he knows he's going to need it to slit the throat of his own son and watch the blood rain down? Can you imagine Abraham going to his father's, Abraham going to his son's bedroom, waking him up in the middle of the night and saying to him, son, come with me. Isaac is probably thinking that his father has a nice surprise for him, not knowing that his daddy is about to sacrifice him on Mount Moriah. Then traveling 3 days, going all the way up to the base of the mountain, telling the servants to stay here, and then being willing to go up there, slit his son's throat, lay him on top of the wood, light the fire, and then go back and tell Sarah what has happened. It's a gut-wrenching story. But believe it or not, although Abraham is called the father of the faithful, and we revere him very much, I have not come here to talk about Abraham. In fact, I would do you a disservice today if I only spoke about that which is conveniently laid on the surface of this text. Today, I would rather talk about that which is not expressly written, but that which is abundantly supplied for us in the text and almost obviously implied. Rewind the tape for a moment back to the first scene. When God says to Abraham, when the word says, God tested Abraham. Brothers and sisters, in this story, if God tested Abraham, he most certainly tested Isaac too. Follow me for a moment. The spirit of prophecy tells us that Isaac was willing to be sacrificed and that Abraham could not have fulfilled this test unless little baby Isaac was willing to go along with it. The word gives us this fact that Isaac was somewhere around 15 to 20 years old, probably fresh into high school or maybe fresh out of high school. Maybe he had not had his first date yet, hadn't gone to prom, hadn't had his first girlfriend, what have you. But Isaac was a very young man. And the word tells us, man, that Abraham wakes him up one morning and they get down to the base of the mountain. And what I really believe in my heart and mind today is this, is that this story should not go past verse 7. The word says, Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, Father, yes, my son, Abraham replied. The fire and the wood are here, Isaac said, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham and Isaac got to the mountain. Abraham tells the servants, yo, stay here. We are going to come back to you. But Isaac, as he is looking around, does not see a lamb for a sacrifice. He has been taught how to sacrifice and how to worship. He's done many sacrifices with his father, but even he in his young mind recognizes you can't worship without a sacrifice. You can't have a real relationship with God without some type of sacrifice. And Isaac is really confused in this moment and saying, I wonder if my dad is experiencing early onset Alzheimer's right now. I wonder if he's having memory loss in his old age. He knows there's no way we can give God anything of meaning unless we have a sacrifice to go along with it. And with this story and with Isaac's words, we get something from this text that is beautiful. Brothers and sisters, you cannot worship God without a sacrifice. We have made Christianity very convenient, even for our young people and our kids. We have carved out a time during the church service. As long as we can worship during 2 hours on Sabbath morning, we are good for the rest of the week. And don't you know, brothers and sisters, this is just a dress rehearsal for how you're going to act outside of these walls. Follow me for a moment. Man, if you can lift your hands and praise God while the music is good and the pianist is playing well, then it really doesn't mean anything if outside these walls you are rude and nasty. If you don't know how to love nobody, you can't be kind or sweet or help somebody when they're in need. Nothing inside these walls really has any amount of value if you're not going to be a Christian out there. What I'm trying to say is that Christianity cannot be convenient for you. You can't just be a Christian when church folk are around. You can't just be a Christian inside of the house of God. There has to be a time in your life where Christianity goes beyond these walls into the workplace and into the grocery store and into the streets and into the highways and hedges. I know today is supposed to be a youth day, but everybody's going to get a word today. You can't worship God without a sacrifice. And Isaac, even in his young mind, recognizes, Daddy, I see the fire. I see the doctrine. And I see the wood. I see all of these things, but where is the lamb for the burnt sacrifice? Daddy, you know good and well, we can't give God. God is not going to accept our sacrifice unless we have something to give him. And I guess what I'm trying to say too today is this. If Christianity can't be convenient, then sometimes you're going to have to learn how to be a Christian and worship God even when it hurts. Man, wish I had help today, man. You're going to have to learn how to be a Christian when there's no music. When your favorite preacher is not here to preach you happy. God, help me today. You're going to have to learn how to praise God in spite of what you're going through.
Worship in Christianity is a sacrifice. And if you're not willing to sacrifice, then you are not a Christian. And here's what I find out more than often in the world is this. We are willing to sacrifice for everything except for God. Help me, Lord, today. You pray and you ask God, God, give me a job. And then when God gives you the job, the supervisor asks you to come in on God's holy day, and you're not willing to sacrifice even for a moment for the job that God gave you. Help me, Lord, today. We are not willing to sacrifice anything unless it is convenient for us. We're not willing to stand up for our friends when we know they are doing the wrong thing. We're not willing to go against the grain. We're not willing to be different. We are more interested in blending in than blending out to other people. There's a problem, brothers and sisters, when we have made Christianity so convenient. You cannot worship God without a sacrifice. Isaac says, Daddy, I see the fire and I see the wood. But where is the lamb for the burnt sacrifice? Now, it's interesting. I was reading this week, and of course, I could have stayed put right on Abraham and talked about his faithfulness. But Isaac teaches us something beautiful as well. Listen up, young people. The word teaches us, man, that Isaac, even at this moment, some scholars in the spirit of prophecy agree, that at this moment, he was beginning to put two and two together in his mind. He was beginning to realize that just like the heathen nations that lived around them, God was asking his father Abraham to sacrifice him on the mountain. And in spite of him knowing that, the word says that they went up on the mountain together. In other words, they went up in agreement. Isaac knows that he is almost certainly headed to his doom, and he goes up the mountain with his father anyway. This is crazy to me. I mean, nobody just goes and gets on a plane that they know is going to crash. Nobody just goes and walks into a building that they know is ultimately going to collapse and fall on their heads. Nobody does that. But Isaac takes his time, realizes what is about to happen, and he still goes up the mountain with his daddy, knowing full well he's about to die there. And you have to ask yourself the question, what would make a young man like Isaac, a teenager, a high schooler, a middle school student, put God in the highest priority of his life so much that he's willing to die for him? Now, I thought about this for a moment, and God brought me 3 points to my mind, and I'm going to give it to you, and I'm going to get out your way because I don't believe that I am a long preacher. Here's number one. Your boy Isaac trusted his father. I'm not talking about his heavenly father. Don't make this more spiritual than it has to be. I'm talking about his earthly father. Isaac trusted Abraham. And the reason he probably trusted Abraham, and we don't have to get so far-fetched in our imagination, is more than likely Abraham told Isaac what God had done for him in the past. It's probably likely that Abraham shared his testimony with Isaac, told him how good God had been to him. And because Isaac and Abraham had such a good relationship, Isaac believed that his father wouldn't do anything to hurt him. Now, if you want our young people to sacrifice for God and to serve God, parents, I hope you're listening for a moment. Man, you have got to have such a relationship with them that they trust you. Now, here's the problem that I have, brothers and sisters. We are so pious. I know I won't get invited back, but it's all good. We are so stuck up that we often allow our kids to believe that we have never done anything wrong in our lives. And while they are dealing with all the foolishness in the world and lesbianism and homosexuality and bullying and violence and drugs and pornography and premarital sex, you gonna stand up there and act like you ain't never done anything? What is the appeal of the church if it's not going to be here for me to help me in my times of need? Your boy Isaac trusted his father because Abraham told him about the stuff that God has done for him. More than likely, he shared his mistakes and how God brought him out. More than likely, he shared with him, listen, if you serve God with all your heart, man, God will take you to higher places unknown. But here's the problem too, brothers and sisters. Come here and listen to me for a moment. Man, you say that you are Christian, but you don't act like you're a Christian. How you gonna get mad when homegirl gets pregnant and you ain't acting right? I know I won't get invited back. Just follow in the spirit. How you gonna expect your kids to worship God if you're not worshiping God the way you're supposed to be doing? There's no prayer in the home. You're not having family worship. The days of saying, do as I say and not as I do are over. Young people are watching you. They need to trust you in order to see God. Sometimes you will be the only Jesus that they will ever see. Your boy Isaac trusted Abraham because he saw in Abraham God. And when Abraham spoke, he took it as if it was the voice of the living God that was speaking to him. Can I tell you something, man? I remember I was very young, lived at my home in Charleston, South Carolina, 1518 Balsam Street. I remember I was in high school, still trying to decide what I was going to do with my life. I was playing around with the idea of going into the ministry because my dad wanted me to, but I said, no, I didn't want to do it. Eventually worked out. Anyway, one night, man, I was wrestling in my bed. I couldn't sleep for whatever reason. I just woke up, you know, in the middle of the night. I said, let me go to the refrigerator. Let me go to the kitchen. Let me get something to eat. Maybe I can go back to sleep after that. You know what, brothers and sisters? I came out, and I walked down the hallway to the kitchen, and I happened to look to the left. And you know what I saw? In the middle of the night, in the darkness, in my living room, I saw my dad on his knees praying. I could hear what he was praying about, praying for his family, praying for his son, praying that God would take care of our needs in our home. Do you know what that did for a young man like me to see my big, strong dad on his knees in the middle of the night praying and seeking God's face? It told me at that moment, God is real. And I'm willing to sacrifice for him, even so much as willing to die for him. Listen, when I saw my dad on his knees, it changed my whole outlook on spirituality. And we wonder why so many of our kids are messed up and you think they don't have it together. Contrary to popular belief, kids want God. They just don't see God in you. They want Jesus. You just ain't got no Jesus in you. We come in the house of God, we praise God all day long, and then they see the hypocritical nature of your life when you go back home and talk about people while you are sitting around the Sabbath potluck dinner table. Y'all not hearing me today, man. How you expect your kids to love God and to serve God, and you ain't got your relationship with God together? You've got to model what you want them to be. And Isaac trusted that he could be sacrificed because he trusted his father, Abraham. I know y'all don't like me today. I'm so sorry. It's the word of God, man. I'm impressed today. You know, I almost feel like doing a Kanye thing today, like Kanye did to Taylor Swift, just getting up on stage and saying, yo, Abraham, like, yo, you did your thing, but your boy Isaac had one of the best performances of all time. Homeboy is on the mountain, and he's willing to go up there and be sacrificed, hear me, to die, to have a knife plunged into his throat and plunged into his chest and then be lit on fire for a sacrifice for God. This is amazing to me. I'm impressed by your boy. One, he trusted his father. Then number two, man, scholars and commentators and Jewish historians agree that in that moment on the mountain, what was probably keeping Isaac there, about to be sacrificed, as Abraham is turning the rope over his wrists and tying the rope around his legs and picking him up and putting him on the wood, man, what kept him there was that Isaac began to think of how undeserving he was. Isaac was a child of promise. Meaning that he was literally a miracle baby. The word tells us that his mother's womb was dead. She was incapable of having children at all. And God, in his sovereign power and blessings and wisdom, opened up her womb and allowed her to have Isaac. In his mind, he's thinking, you know what? I don't even have a right to be alive in the first place. So what is it if God asks for my life right now on this mountain? He said to himself, I'm undeserving for the breath that is in my body. I'm undeserving of the blood that is in my veins. I'm undeserving of anything that I have in my life. If God wants to take my life, then surely he can have it. Okay. I think young people today, what we should think about more than anything else when it comes to God and when it comes to sacrificing is the mere fact that you don't even deserve to be alive today. Hear me, brothers and sisters. You don't deserve the heart that is beating inside your chest right now. You did not wake up this morning and flip a switch and cause your heart to start beating. You did not tell your veins to pump blood. You did not tell your lungs to keep pumping in and out air right now, inhaling and exhaling. You are literally living on the grace of Almighty God. Had it not been for the grace of God, every time you sin, your heart should stop beating. Your lungs should collapse. You should go into respiratory failure, and you should die. Isaac said, I don't even deserve to be alive. If this is what God wants me to do, then hurry up, Abraham, and tie the knot. Spirit of prophecy tells us, man, that in fact on that mountain, Isaac considered it an honor to die for God. In fact, he encouraged his father once he realized what was happening. Daddy, if this is for God, hurry up, tie the knot. Get me on the altar, slit my throat, light the fire, and let me die if this is what God wants from me. She also says that Isaac in his youth, man, was about 15 or 20 years old, whatever, but he was significantly younger than his father. His father Abraham was somewhere around 120 years old. That's even old for Old Testament times. And easily, if Isaac wanted to, he could have easily overpowered Abraham and called back down to the mountain and say, yo, servants, my dad has just lost his cotton picking mind. Y'all come up in here and help me and let's go back to my mom. But he realized in that moment, you know what? I don't even deserve to be here. And if this is what God wants from my life, then I'm willing to do it. Now, just as Isaac could have overpowered Abraham, although we cannot overpower God, we can overrule him in our lives. God gives us free will. God allows you to choose for yourself. He has a plan. He has a set agenda that he wants to accomplish in your life. He has a set purpose of things that he wants you to do in your life. Hear me, young people, today. But we can overrule God's agenda and choose to go our own way. What you don't understand is that God created you. I said, God created you. God created you. Then how is it that we are living manifestations and living creations of Jay-Z, Beyonce, Nicki Minaj, Drake, Waka Flocka? How is it that we pattern our lives after what we see on TV when God has created us? We overrule what God wants to do in our lives time and time and time again. And God is saying, yo, I have a plan for your life. You don't even deserve to be here. Yet you're going to mess it up and go do your own thing? We'll sacrifice for everything and anything except for God. We will save mad money for mad long for a pair of Jordans that won't last us 365 days, but you won't come to church on time. You won't tell your friends no. You won't stop hanging out with that girl or that boy when God wants to give you eternal life. We sacrifice for the things that we want. Will we not sacrifice for God? And in Isaac's young mind, he realizes, man, I am undeserving of the very life that I have. And if God should ask for my breath back to him, then I'll give it to him. If God wants my life, I'll give him back the blood that is his. If God wants my life, I'll give him back the body that is his. The word says, don't you know that your bodies are not your own? That you are a temple of the living God, that you are bought with a price. Your body is not your own. You can't treat your life like a theme park.
Wish I had help today, man.
You can't do whatever you want to do. God has something that he wants to accomplish in you, and it ought to scare you half to death that you're going to miss out on what God has because you ain't willing to sacrifice nothing. It's crazy. You know how the world works. You know you don't get nothing for free in this life. You know you got to work for stuff. You know you're going to have to go without sometimes to get what you really want. You don't think the same is true of God? You don't think God wants you to stand up when it's difficult? Do you think God only wants you to come up in the house of God just like a herd of people every single week and praise God for 2 hours and not do anything outside of that time frame? Help me, Lord, today. You don't think God wants you to screen what you watch and what you listen to? You don't think God wants you to sacrifice from time to time? You don't think God wants you to give up friends and people that have nothing or want nothing to do with God? Isaac trusted his daddy. Isaac believed that he was undeserving, and homeboy was ready to die for God. We're not talking about a symbolic spiritual death. I'm talking about real death. Where the curtains are closing, the fat lady sings, you see a light in the tunnel. He is about to die, and he knows it. And he goes willingly. His father does not have to force him to do it. His mama surely didn't know anything about it. The servants didn't force him. The Bible says that Abraham lays the wood on Isaac's back, and he carries it up the mountain. He is carrying the wood that is going to burn him alive. He knows that there's a knife inside of Abraham's satchel that's going to slit his throat. I wish y'all could get with me today. Man, he knows that he's going to die. And a young high school age boy decides, yes, God, I will die for you. Trusted his father. He knew that he was undeserving. And then finally, I believe this man, he trusted God's will. In the moment, Isaac must have realized, yo, God, whatever you want to do is fine with me. Abraham, Isaac must have realized in that moment, man, God, if you require my life, then there has to be a reason why you are asking for it. If you are asking me to break up with my boyfriend, there's got to be a good reason. If you are asking me to quit my job, there's got to be a good reason for it, God. If you allowed so-and-so to die in my life, there's got to be a good reason for it, God. Whatever you're asking me to do, I don't understand it. In fact, I don't have to understand it right now. But I know that it is the will of God. And as long as I'm in the center of God's will, everything's going to be all right. Isaac recognizes this as a very young boy. And I am sick and tired of playing games, brothers and sisters. We are living in what we call the last days. Y'all not hearing me today. Where all of us are going to be brought up on charges. Where all of us may have to face death for real. It's high time we stop making Christianity convenient. Even for our young people, I want them to love God and I want them to have a relationship with him, but we have to tell them the truth, and a youth day is not enough to give them a relationship with God. This is nothing. This is 30 minutes of time of the word of God. This means nothing. Preach all over the world. I do youth week of prayers, crusades, 1 week, 2 weeks at a time. Preach to the young kids. Give them everything I got. Sweat myself to death. And believe it or not, the kids go home to their parents, and the parents' household and the environment and the atmosphere of their homes uproots everything that has been said. It's high time we stop playing games and recognize, man, that when we follow God, it is a sacrifice. That God is calling us to give up something. You know what the word says, man? The word says one day Jesus is walking and a whole bunch of people are following him, like thousands of people. And finally Jesus gets fed up, turns around and says to them, listen, if any of you want to follow me, you must deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. Then he says, if anyone wants to follow me, let them count the cost first. He's letting you know it's not easy to follow me. And in fact, God says, if you call yourself a Christian and you're not willing to sacrifice, then you're taking my name in vain. God wants us to be willing to stand up for him even when times get tough. Help me, Lord, today. Isaac realized, man, he's in the center of God's will. If this is what God wants, then Abraham, daddy, man, hurry up, tie the knot, put me on top of the wood, man, burn me alive, do whatever you have to do. I just trust God so much that God knows what he is doing. And worship is a sacrifice, brothers and sisters. Let's stop training our kids that if they come to a service, it's going to be all right. Let's stop training our young people into thinking that Christianity is easy just on Sabbath. Let's stop training our kids, man, letting them think that Christianity is just some easy, comfortable thing that they do. It is not, brothers and sisters. We have to be willing to sacrifice. We got to be willing to give up friends. We got to be willing to give up what we want to do, and so that God's purposes can be fulfilled in our lives. I'm impressed today by this young man, Isaac, who is willing to say, God, you are first in my life. For God I'll live, and for God I'll die. I wonder what's being taught in our homes. I wonder what our kids are getting. I wonder if there's any kind of family worship going on. I wonder if we're actually praying for the kids, or we expect the youth pastor to do all the work. I wonder if our kids actually know that you're a Christian, or they're still wondering about it. I wonder if they hear God's name on your lips throughout the week. I wonder if they could walk into your room one time and see you actually praying, because you're always interceding for them. I wonder if they'll see you being willing to sacrifice for him as well, and maybe they will do the same. All of our kids are not bad. I know what you wanted. You wanted me to talk to the young people today. You wanted me to beat them over the head. Not going to happen today. Truth of the matter is, contrary to popular belief, they want God. They just don't see God in you. Isaac is willing to die, because he heard the testimony of his father. He trusted his father in everything that he said. And he realized that when his father spoke, it was the voice of God speaking. Can I just say this real quick? This ain't in my notes. I'm off script now, so just forget about it. Here's the thing, man. Yo, can you be willing to talk to your kids? Okay. Can you be willing to share with them what God has done for you and how God has brought you out? Can you be willing and open and transparent enough to say, there but for the grace of God go I? If God hadn't saved me back in 1999, I'd be dead right now. The only reason I'm telling you this today is because, yo, I don't want you to walk and fall into the same pit that I fell in my life. Can you be willing to do that? Or are you just going to let them go off by themselves and let them make their own mistakes and fall into a pit and sometimes never recover from it? Or are you willing to tell them the truth and let them know, I made some bad mistakes in my life, I messed up real bad, and God saved me? I don't want you to make the same mistake. If you do that, your kids are more willing to be like Isaac. They're more willing to stand up for God, because they'll recognize what God has done for you in your life. Isaac trusted God. He believed he was undeserving, and he even trusted God's will. Now check this out, man. Follow the word of God. The word says in verse 7, Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, Father, yes, my son. Abraham replied, the fire and the wood are here, Isaac said, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham answered, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. And the two of them went on together. When they reached the place God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac, and he laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, Abraham, Abraham, here I am, he replied. Do not lay a hand on the boy, he said. Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son. Abraham looked up, and there in a thicket he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. And so Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." And to this day, it is said, on the mountain of the Lord will provide. Here's the thing, young people, listen to me for a moment. Man, if you are willing to sacrifice for God, you will always get something back in return. But what you lose in giving up for the world, you lose it forever. You'll never get it back. But what you put into the hands of God, that thing being your very life, God will take care of you. When you sacrifice for God, God makes himself personally responsible for your success. God will open up windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive it. If you sacrifice the prom and the game and the basketball game and the job for God's holy day, God will cause you to ride upon the high places of the earth. Isaac sacrificed himself for God. And God provided another way of escape. But what you lose for the world, you will never get back. You lose your virginity to the world. Wish I could preach the truth today. You lose your body to the world, they never give it back. You lose your mind to the world, you never get it back. But what you sacrifice for God, God will take care of you. 28 years old right now, and I am right now in my life. Man, I am a living, breathing statistic breaker. Hallelujah. 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 It's not because I'm so smart, not even because I'm just so spirit-filled. I just decided one day in my room, God, for you I'll live, and for God I will die. Whatever you want me to do, God, I will do it in my life. I'll sacrifice. I won't date this type of girl. Somebody say amen. I won't hang out with these type of people. I won't choose this type of job. I will not go this type of place. And right now in my life, I am literally coasting on the blessings of God. For Isaac is willing to sacrifice, man, and God provides another way. Then verse 15, I got to get out of here already. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars of the sky and as the sand of the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring all nations on the earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me." And it's real good for us because when we look at this passage, we automatically think of how faithful Abraham is. Well, if Abraham shows us that God is faithful, then Isaac shows us how much God is willing to sacrifice for us. Now, check this out. I'm not telling you that you got to go somewhere and strap a bomb to your chest and blow yourself up in the name of God. That's not what I'm asking. I'm not telling you that you got to go somewhere and preach the good news in a foreign land and end up being hanged or shot for Jesus. That's not what I'm asking. Jesus is asking us right now to live a dying life. The word says in Romans 12, "I beseech ye therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God." God wants you to live your life in a dying way that gives him glory. God's not asking you to die physically or temporally on this earth. God is asking you to die on a daily basis. That means that you'll make no major decision in your life without talking to God first. That means you just ain't gonna marry anybody that you see, or some girl that's just fine that don't want anything to do with God. And further, the statistic that says 50% of marriages inside and outside of the church end in divorce. God says, "I just want you to make a decision in your life. You just ain't gonna sleep with anybody." God said, "I just want you to make a decision that you're just not gonna put any and everything in your body." God said, "I just want you to be willing to sacrifice and to die on a daily basis. I want you to put your wants and your desires second to mine every single time. I beseech you, brethren, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice that is holy and that is acceptable unto God." I don't know about you, but I'm impressed by Isaac today. A young man willing to give up everything for God. And I wonder today about our young people. Are you willing to sacrifice
for God? Are you willing to be unpopular so that God's purposes can be fulfilled in your life? Okay, let me try to be more real, and I ain't trying to scare nobody today. This is the truth. There is a time coming, brothers and sisters, where we won't even be able to meet in houses of worship. There is a time coming we're not going to have no praise team. We're not going to have no band. We're not going to have no pastor standing at the pulpit looking cute, preaching the word of God to preach us happy so we can go home and eat veggie meat and come back the next week for our usual injection of spirituality. We're not going to have that, brothers and sisters. There is a day coming when we will be running to the hills, and we will have to make our calling and election sure. And we need to start making that decision right now that for God I'll live and for God I'll die. 1999, in Colorado, a young girl by the name of Cassie Bernal went to school just like any other day. Nobody really knows her story, but she had a troubled teenage life and decided to give her life to Christ. And every day she wore a bracelet that said, WWJD, what would Jesus do? From the time of her conversion, she let everybody know how much she loved Jesus and how much Jesus loved them. It was on that day in 1999 that two gunmen walked into the school and began to shoot up the place. Cassie was there just like everybody else, a little fearful for her life, but unlike everybody else, she was on her knees praying and asking God for deliverance. The young man who came into the school at Columbine went around and told people everywhere, listen, if you believe in God, you will be shot and killed. Cassie stood there on her knees praying and seeking God's guidance. Finally, one of the gunmen came to her and put a gun to her temple and said to her, listen, unless you renounce Jesus Christ, I'm going to blow your brains out. Put the gun to her head and asked her, okay, do you believe in Jesus? And believe it or not, homegirl, very young, somewhere around the age of Isaac, said, yes, I believe in Jesus, for he died for my, boom, and blew her brains out. Her mama wrote a book about it and told the story of how troubled her past was and how she gave her life to Christ. And her mother really believes that this young girl, Cassie, did this because she had fallen in love with Jesus. Now, I'm not telling you that when somebody puts a gun to your head or you got to put yourself in a position where you are just ready to die physically, but I am telling you this, that one day, very soon, brothers and sisters, we're going to have to make our calling and election sure. You're going to have to be willing to decide for yourself, I'm going to serve God for the rest of my life. Church is not enough. God wants all of you, but the devil doesn't mind sharing you. The devil doesn't mind sharing you because he knows if he has even a small part of you, God does not have all of you. And if you choose not to make a decision today, man, you have already made up your mind. I'm impressed today by Isaac. I love Abraham too, father of the faithful. But brothers and sisters, I'm trying to start something new in this generation right now where we are willing to stand up for God. Sister White says an army rightly trained of young people will finish the work. Let's get serious about God and let's just not serve God for what he can do for us. Let's not tell our kids that they're going to be blessed if they serve God and that they should follow him just because of that. God's going to pour out blessings on them. Yes, he will, but serve God because he's God. Because he died on the cross for your sins. That his blood allows you to be living right now who believes God's word. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed, I'm done. Y'all ain't going to get with me today no matter what I say, so I'm going to put it this way. God is asking us to surrender all. I did not say a part. I did not say a piece. I said everything that you are, everything that you ever will be, God is asking you to give it all up. If Isaac could do it, we can too. Now, here it is. Now in my life, I don't make any major decisions without talking to God first. You know what? Your boy, I'm engaged right now. Let the church say amen. In 2 weeks, literally, September 13th, is my wedding day. My wife is future wife. She's beautiful. She's smart. She can sing. She loves the Lord. All of these things. It would seem like it would be an easy decision just to marry her. Do you know how much time I spent in prayer before I even thought about proposing to her? Y'all ain't hearing me today. Your boy was on his knees pleading, God, if this is not your will, close the door. If this not the girl you want me to be with, I want to be with her, God. But if it's not what you want, then don't let it happen. God wants you to say, listen, I ain't asking you to die a physical death right now. I already did that for you. I died for you already. All I'm asking is that, yo, could you please just don't make any major decision? Don't just choose somebody to marry without talking to me first. God's like, I already died for you. You ain't got to die, but could you just do me a favor? Could you not just put all kind of crazy stuff in your body? Could you do that for me? Could you do me a favor? God's like, I already died for you. I'm not asking you to die, but could you not just sleep with anybody? Could you not just allow anybody to try it before they buy it? Can you do that? God is like, I love you so much. I already paid the price that you should have paid for your sins. Every time you sin, you should have died. But God is like, yo, can you just do me a favor and be willing to sacrifice from time to time for me? God said, I promise I'll save you. So here's what I want to do. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. This ain't between nobody else. I don't care about the music. I don't care how good the sermon was, how eloquent it was. You know where you are with God. Check this out. If you want God and you're just saying, I want to surrender all today, Pastor Coaxum, you never tried it before, I want you to come down to front right now. Don't even think about it. It's not that big a deal. If you want to surrender all to Jesus Christ, you just come down here. Nobody need to be looking around to see who's coming, why they're coming, what's going on in their life. Has nothing to do with that. But if you want God today, you're saying, I want to surrender all to him. I want you to make your way down here right now. That's young and old. I love youth days, you know, but truth is, if there's adults in the audience, the adults need a word too. So if that's you, you need to come down. Come on, say amen. Where are you today? I want to give my all to God, everything that I am. I want to lay it out on the altar.